says the people themselves will be the ultimate makers of their constitution. And so I'm excited to introduce today's featured speakers because they've actually done that. They've taken the steps to change the way we think about our constitution and the way the constitution relates to our lives. So with that, I would like to introduce Simon Tam, musician, author, and activist. He's best known as the bassist and founder of the Asian American dance rock band, the Slants, who won their case against the government at the United States Supreme Court. After he shares his remarkable story, which we'll do over the next few minutes, we'll have a few minutes at the end for questions from the audience. So as we're going through the program today, think about some questions you might want to ask. So please join me in welcoming today Simon Tam, who was joined on stage by Joe Jiang, the guitarist for the Slants. Ladies and gentlemen, the Slants.
So we're going to begin with a song about the 18th and the 21st Amendments, which you can read all about here in the Constitution Center.
And it won't apply to most of you for many, many years.
Remember grasping for moments. Freedom was a digit away. Remember thinking the world closed up on you like an island, hearing through sea and remember when you were teenage, staring up at the ceiling, emotions like a runaway train. Remember making the promise to yourself not to be cautious, flawless and wondering.
Held by rules, now you're free to run. out to those four over there that started the wave, and it spread out through the entire room. That's how change happens.
That's how change happens.
Oh, yeah.
So this next song is a song that we wrote, and we actually wrote it specifically for the government, because we went up to the U.S. Supreme Court fighting for the rights to our name, and I'll get into a little bit more of that in a second, but we thought we'd invite you to be a part of this. You're obviously great at waving and catching on lyrics.
We're ready.
So all you got to do to sing along is know one word, and that word is no. So when we point at you,
these kids here, they knew the words already.
They already knew. I know. Well, I'm just
backup singers, harmonies, and everything.
So
fantastic.
All you got to do is when we point at you, you just yell out the word no. So let's try it. 3, 2, 1.
No!
3, 2, 1.
No!
You already know the song.
Sorry if our note's too sharp. Sorry if our voice too rough. Don't make the pen a weapon and censor our intelligence and tell our thoughts ain't nothing at all. Sorry if y'all take offense. You're made of rules and play pretend. We know you fear change. Something so strange, but nothing's gonna get in our way. There's no rules for your backwards. Back
your
feelings, you're never gonna settle.
Right, here we go,
Kim. No! We won't remain silent.
No!
It's a defining moment. We sing from the heart. We sing from the heart. No! We won't be complacent.
No!
It's a rock and roll nation. We sing from the heart.
We sing from the heart.
We sing from the heart.
That's really good.
Sorry if we try too hard. Take some power back for ours. The language of oppression will lose to education until the word can hurt us again. Sorry if y'all take offense. The silence will not make offense. The system's all wrong. It won't be long before the kids are clapping along. There's no room for you backwards. The backyard feelings are never gonna settle, never gonna settle. And no, we won't remain silent.
No,
it's a defining moment. We sing from the heart.
We sing from the heart.
We sing from the heart.
We sing from the
no.
We won't be complacent.
No,
it's a rock and roll nation. We sing from the heart.
We sing from the heart.
Yeah, we sing from the heart.
Go.
1, 2, 3, go!
Yeah.
We won't remain silent.
Yeah.
It's a defining moment. We sing from the heart.
We sing from the heart.
We sing from the heart.
We sing from the
heart.
We won't be complacent.
Yeah.
It's a rock and roll nation. We sing from the heart.
We sing from the heart.
We sing from the heart.
Acapella style. Sing from the heart.
No, we won't be complacent.
No,
it's a rock and roll nation. We sing from the heart. We sing from the
heart.
Thank you.
Yeah, give yourselves a round of applause. That was awesome. That was the best we've ever had. So, we're the Slants. We're an Asian American band. Normally we play dance pop music, but today is a little bit more of our, you know, Slants light, acoustic kind of stuff. We travel around the country. We oftentimes talk about our story of what it was like to fight for the rights to our name and to go up to the nation's highest court. But I oftentimes like to begin in a very different place, one that still has to do with law, but that looks very different than the high court. And that begins at the Oregon State Penitentiary. You see, in 2011, our band was invited to play at OSP, the maximum security prison in Oregon. Now, I thought it was going to be this exciting thing. I'd never really thought what it would mean to send an all-Asian band into a prison with one of the highest populations of neo-Nazis in the country. Like, what that would be like, how it could possibly be dangerous. It actually didn't cross my mind until we were going through our second set of metal detectors. And it was at that point we were given these bright orange safety vests with big numbers on them, like the kind you would play if you were gonna go play flag football. As we were making our way through the prison, we are eventually led to some place called the Big Yard. Now, the Big Yard is the size of a couple of football fields in length. It's surrounded by 30-foot-high walls made out of solid concrete, and throughout the walls were towers with searchlights and mounts for machine guns. Now, what I noticed at that day is, like, the only thing that was going to be separating us from about 2,000 inmates were bright orange safety cones and a thin line of police tape that said, "Police, do not cross." But of course, I didn't think that would stop them if they really wanted to get to us. It didn't really matter though, because we took the stage anyway. And whenever we have a chance to share our music with people, there's just something really powerful about that. Just like being able to share some of our songs with you and having you clap and sing along, it's incredible. Well, on that day, I watched as a small crowd that was gathered in front, the crowd that was enjoying their only hour of outdoor time that day, I watched as it grew and grew. And they were on such good behavior that the guards said, you know, let's go ahead and double their hour of outdoor time that day. So it really made the concert even longer. Eventually, we got to a cover of a song by the Rolling Stones called Paint It Black. And when we launched into this, I remember looking out in the audience and seeing this ocean of orange jumpsuits start jumping up and down in front of us.
I see a red door and I want to paint it black. No colors anymore, I want it to turn black. I see the girls walk by dressed.
And after we finished playing, I remember hanging out by one of those safety cones, by the police tape, on the safe side, of course. And I looked out and I saw a group of large, shirtless white men started to walk towards me. They're covered head to toe in tattoos. And I couldn't really make out what they were because I didn't have my glasses on at the time. But as they got closer and closer, the guy in front had two words that became very clear to me: white power. Right across his chest. Now, I started getting nervous. I looked for my bandmates, and they're 20 feet away from me breaking down equipment. I looked for the guard, the one who's supposed to be helping us out with this event, and he's 50 feet away, breaking up a different fight. I turn back around, and the man's just an arm's length away from me. He looks a bit nervous himself, and then he hands me a piece of paper and a very sharp pencil. I'm frozen. Like, the only thing going through my mind at that moment is that scene in Jurassic Park where they're like, if you don't move, the T-Rex won't see you. But of course, he already saw me. And then he says those few words that just cuts right through me. "It's for my daughter. Will you please sign it?" I said, of course I'll sign it. And I turn the paper over. It's a makeshift flyer of our concert that day at the prison. And we start having this short conversation, mostly me asking questions about his daughter, like what grade she's in and what kind of, you know, what's her favorite animal, avoiding questions like, "So why are you in here?" Because it seemed kind of obvious. And as we're having this short exchange, he looks at me and says, "You know, the fact that you came in here, that you'd be willing to share your music with us and be willing to talk to me, it's incredible." Says, "You know, I've made a lot of mistakes in my life, and they're ones I don't want my little girl to make. I can't change what's stained into my skin, but I could change what's in my heart. It was one of the most powerful experiences I've ever had as a musician because we walked in there full of assumptions. I was literally judging the guy by his skin. I mean, granted, it said white power up on there, but like, you know, I'm sure he had a bunch of assumptions about me as well. But once we actually had a chance to talk, to engage, we both walked away changed that day. I started the Slants in 2006 because I wanted to change people's assumptions about Asian Americans. You see, I grew up in the 80s in San Diego, California, and back then, there wasn't a lot of representation in movies or TV shows, and definitely not in music. So as a result, I was bullied a lot. I was violently attacked multiple times as a kid. There's this one time in seventh grade that always jumps out in my mind. I see, back then, after PE, we would have to take turns cleaning up the yard while everyone else would go and hit the showers or get ready for classes. And on this particular day, I thought I was alone out there as I was picking up the basketballs and cleaning up the volleyball nets. But I very quickly realized I wasn't when I could feel myself being shoved to the ground, hard. I turn around and there's four guys standing over me. And the thing that is the most scary to me isn't that there's four of them, but that they're smiling, they're grinning, they're actually enjoying that moment. And then they began just hitting me over and over again, hitting me in the face, kicking me in the stomach, throwing sand in my eyes, all while yelling two words again and again, Jap and Gook. I was terrified. I didn't really know how to respond until one point I just kind of snapped and I said, hey, I'm a chink. Like, that's how stupid you are. You can't even be racist properly. They immediately stopped. They were stunned. They walked away. You see, there's power in claiming an identity. There's power in saying, you don't get to define who I am. Only I get to decide that. I get to make the choices about the words that I want to identify with. And I think some part of that lesson stuck with me because many years later, when I moved to Portland, Oregon, I decided to start an Asian American band, one that would provide representation for our community. And I called it the Slants. I wanted to call it the Slants because I wanted to talk about our perspective or our slant on life of what it's like to be Asian American in the music industry. I also wanted to address the fact that, you know, slanted eyes shouldn't be something you're ashamed of, but should be something you could be proud of, and that this old racial slur is kind of obscure and outdated. So I wanted to flip it on its head. I didn't realize the kind of reaction that we would get. Kids started writing to me from all across the country saying thank you. Thank you for showing me that I could be something else. Thank you for like being out there. Thank you for sharing your own stories of being bullied, because I've been bullied too. And I know what it's like. And I want to know that it does get better. We would do things like, we started incorporating our work with social justice organizations and working with anti-bullying programs, and we even wrote songs about it as well. So one of our songs, Sakura Sakura, is based off an old schoolyard rhyme. You see, kids used to come up to me and my old singer and say, Chinese, Japanese, dirty knees, look at these. And they'd pull their eyes back in a slant-eyed gesture as they laughed at us. We said, you know what, why not take it, flip it around, own it. And that's when the song Sakura Sakura was born.
We sing for the Japanese and the Chinese and all the dirty. Please can you see me? We sing in harmony. We sing for the Japanese and the Chinese and all the dirty. Please can you see me? We sing in harmony.
Everything was going amazing. We were touring across the country. We were getting radio play in like 800 stations. We were getting spin on Conan O'Brien. Like, we were playing anime conventions and video game conventions and doing all kinds of really amazing stuff. But all of it went downhill when I became friends with an attorney. Now, my friend Spencer says, Simon, have you ever thought about applying to register for your trademark? And of course, I thought this thing was going to be really expensive and tough to do, but we ended up deciding to moving forward with it. It's something that like nearly every every band, every artist out there has, because it's so important. It's part of your career. In fact, back in the day when Beyonce was getting signed for Destiny's Child, the record label wouldn't even sign them because they're originally called Destiny, and the label thought it was too generic. They're like, we're not gonna sign you unless you change your name to something unique. That way you can get a registered trademark. Like, that's how important it is. So as we were going through this process, a few months later, Spencer calls me up and says, hey, Simon, you got a problem with your trademark. I'm like, well, what is it? He says, the government, they think your name is disparaging to people of Asian descent. In other words, the government were saying we are racist to ourselves. I was like, I didn't even know there was a law against this. Like, there's all kinds of offensive stuff out there. What does it actually say? And he proceeds to read me this old law that says you can't register marks that the government considers scandalous, immoral, or disparaging. And so we decided to fight it. We decided to fight it in the most, the most logical way possible. Because, like, think about it. If someone was like, prove to me you're not offensive to yourself, what would you say? What kind of evidence would you bring to the table? We went like a very academic, lawyerly kind of route. We got independent national surveys. We got professors to write reports about it. We got a dictionary expert. Like, thousands and thousands of pages of evidence. And it turns out the only bit of evidence the government had was an entry on urbandictionary.com. That's right, the kind of site you can't use in the class was being used by the federal government to deny us this right, saying that they knew better than us what was good for our community. So we continued to fight and fight and fight, losing every single round along the way. It wasn't until we changed our argument, we flipped it, and decided to rely on the First Amendment, our freedom of speech rights, that we saw the tide begin to change. It was there that the federal court system recognized that, hey, maybe the law that we are fighting against is actually unconstitutional. And so we went up through the federal circuit, and that's what eventually took us all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court. And I'll never forget, like, being there. It's like the weirdest thing, because you're there in the nation's highest court. You got justices of the Supreme Court. You got the highest attorney ranked by the government, all talking about how we were offensive to ourselves, like making me feel so invisible, because I was like, wait, don't I get to say something about this? I'm fighting for freedom of speech and I can't say anything in that room. They're all arguing about what's offensive to Asian people, but the only Asian people in the room can't say anything about it. It wasn't until about halfway through the arguments that this little voice pops up. It's Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And she says, hey, doesn't it matter that everyone knows the band is Asian? They're not using the word to disparage, but to describe and to remove the sting from the word. And I just remember thinking, yo, I think I'm in love with the Supreme Court justice. Like, notorious RBG saw us, finally. But if it wasn't for the efforts of our community standing up and fighting for ourselves, I don't know if that would have ever happened. 7.5 years was how long I was stuck in the court system until we got to that point before the Supreme Court. And I remember walking out of that courtroom just feeling just this mess of emotions, like thinking, like, what did I spend my life doing? I spent thousands and thousands of dollars fighting this case. I spent years of my life, almost a quarter of my life, think about it, almost 10 years in the court system. What for? But as I was walking down the steps outside the Supreme Court, I'll never forget, as we got down out there, I looked out and there was just a plaza full of people, like maybe a couple hundred people out there. And I just, as we walked down the steps, we finally hit the ground, and these two Asian kids ran up to me. They said, Simon, our parents let us ditch school to be here. And I was like, what kind of Asian parents do you have? They're like, no, you don't understand. We flew from California to be here. We waited all night on that cold sidewalk so we could be in that room. But there were just too many people. We wanted to meet you because we wanted to tell you that we're freshmen in high school. And you know, for our whole lives, we heard about you. We heard about the one that was willing to fight for the dignity of our community, for us to be able to say what's best for ourselves, not to have some government guy do that. So we want you to know that when we graduate high school, we're going to study public policy development in college. And when we graduate from there, we're going to run for office and change the system that you fought against. A lot of times, like even my whole life growing up, I wondered, like, how could I make a difference in this particular world? And I'm just one example of many. Like, I originally dropped out of college to tour in a punk rock band. I didn't expect to be at the nation's highest court, like helping strengthen our First Amendment. And, you know, a question that I oftentimes would get was, like, why did you fight? Why did you choose this? Of course, it had to do with this ability for us to, like, have that right to choose what's best for ourselves. But it was also because of this. The law that we fought against, it was written in 1939, in the height of the Jim Crow era, where the government was writing laws specifically to target people of color. And it turns out the way that they were using the law was primarily targeting queer communities and people of color, because we tend to be the groups that reappropriate language, taking ownership of them. But that made us targets under the law. Because I was like, if the government actually truly cared about fighting against racism, why didn't they begin by canceling the trademarks of the KKK or Stormfront or other hate groups? Why did they choose to fight that battle against an anti-racist band? It's because they didn't actually care. All they wanted to do was look good. They wanted to, you know, protect the country from bad language, so to speak, all while upholding this bad law. So if you ever are wondering, like, what you can do to make a difference, like, it all begins with understanding what your rights are and learning to fight for those rights. And I'll just close with this, like, a couple days before we went up to the Supreme Court, we celebrated by playing that song, From the Heart, on the steps of the Supreme Court, and then walking down the street to the Martin Luther King Jr. Center, because it was MLK Day. We brought our guitars and we started singing with folks there. For me, it was like a different kind of moment, though, because for me, I was now arriving with a totally different band. Everyone else who was in the group had already left. They walked away from it because they didn't want to be in a legal project. They wanted to be in a band. So the guys that I brought with me were entirely new. I had to keep the band going just to fight this case. And as a result, I needed to take some time out to myself to process. Now, I remember walking around the MLK Center, just meditating on each of the quotes that are carved into stone from this amazing civil rights leader. And I'll always remember seeing my favorite words right there before me, lit up. It says, "The moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice." And as I was staring at those words, I was thinking, 7.5 years. You know, that moral arc, it doesn't bend on its own. It requires patience, it requires people, and it requires persistence. So I think in terms of our future, it depends on people like you, understanding your rights and being willing to fight for those rights. So thank you so much for being here. The other people in the slideshow? Yeah, those are other band members that I've had over the years. So some of them present and some of them are former band members. Oh, I'm sorry? Why are they not here today? A lot of them are retired from the band. Yeah, I'm still making music. In fact, we just released an album in March, and we're producing another album right now. We actually also started a nonprofit organization, so we're going to be providing scholarships and mentoring to artists of color who want to incorporate activism into their work.
What words did you use for encouragement when you were going through the 7 years for your name?
Well, words of encouragement. Well, a lot of the things that encouraged me the most were quotes from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So things like the moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And then another quote in particular, he oftentimes would say, an injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Because a lot of people are like, what's the big deal? It's just a trademark. And I'm like, we shouldn't have to be second-class citizens. We should have that right. And it just kept me like engaged in that work, realizing that it was important and it was worthwhile. Because now artists and nonprofits and small business owners can really choose for themselves how to use language as a way to like move justice forward.
What was your first song?
What was my first song? The first song that we had was a song called We Will Never Die on our album Slanted Eyes, Slanted Hearts.
Can we find you guys on YouTube?
Yeah, we're on YouTube, Spotify, Pandora, Tidal, whatever you like to use.
One over here.
Musically, what was one of your biggest inspirations?
Well, I grew up in the 80s, so I love 80s music. So a lot of our music comes from like The Cure, Depeche Mode, bands kind of like that. But I also grew up loving punk rock, so groups like the Ramones. Though the reality is that we listen to like anything and everything.
How many likes do you have on YouTube?
I don't know how many like likes or thumbs ups we have on YouTube. I know we've had like a million plays or something like that. I don't know how many subscribers we have. I haven't logged in a while.
Over here. Are you allowed to sign anything?
Am I allowed to what?
Sign anything?
Sign anything? Yeah. Sure.
We can do autographs after the show.
Yeah. How did I feel when what?
When you fought for your trademark.
When I fought for it. Well, most of the time I was tired. I was like, this is taking way too long. I was also really frustrated. But when I won, it was like I felt like this huge weight was lifted off of my shoulders. Like on that day, I remember I called my mom up and she's like, congratulations for winning. But she also said, I hope you can smile again. And I'm like, what do you mean, Mom? And she's like, for the last few years, all you do is work and worry. I want my son back. So that fight really did exhaust me to a point where even my family was like, you're not even who you are anymore.
How did the original band meet?
I'm sorry, what's that?
How did you and the original band meet?
We met online, so I put a lot of ads out on Craigslist, and a lot of the band members I have now found some online ads and mutual friends.
One over here.
Did the judges know that your entire band was all Asian?
Yeah, so a couple years into it, when we asked them, they said, wait, if slant is this racial slur that you say it is, how come you gave it to everyone else? You see, the government had over 800 trademarks for slant in the system. I was the only one who was ever denied. And we said, why? Well, the government said we were too Asian to use the name The Slants. Too Asian. They said like, as long as, that was their rationale. Because they're like, hey, if we see the words The Slants and we see your faces, people are automatically gonna think racial slur instead of any other definition. But it was just another way of saying anyone can register this word as long as they're not Asian. So they definitely knew.
Are you looking for new members to join your crew?
Are we looking for new band members? You thinking of auditioning?
Somebody wants to try out.
Well, right now we're not looking for new band members because we're retiring this fall. So after November, we're not playing any more live shows. But what we are doing is looking for other artists to collaborate with and to feature on our next album. So we're still going to be producing music, just not touring and playing music.
Oh, did you recognize that the government was using Urban Dictionary out of everybody?
Yes. So you can actually look at the evidence that they provide and the reasons why they kind of deny you your application. We're not the only people to be denied because of UrbanDictionary.com. They actually use it all the time because it's like one of the first things that pop up when you Google something.
When did your group like start?
I'm sorry, when did my what?
When did your group start?
We started in 2006. So, yeah, it's been a minute.
Good question?
Yeah. Did y'all have any other names other than the Slants?
No, we've always been the Slants. That's been our only band name.
Do you have any kids?
I don't have any kids. I got an amazing dog. he's like my kid.
We have time for one more question. Okay, I think you're our last one.
I'll go now.
Yep.
I guess you're closing us out.
When you was in the
That's loud.
It's okay, go ahead.
When you was in court, like, Was it people in there that wasn't supporting you, or everybody in the court was supporting you?
Were the groups that were supporting us in the courtroom?
Was it like only supporters, or was it like hatred too?
So most of the people that were in the Supreme Court that day were just kind of like casually watching. The cool thing about this is that anyone can walk into the Supreme Court and watch cases being argued there. Our case was one of the... It was probably one of the more talked about cases in 2017, so there was like a huge line for ours. But for kind of the smaller cases, like especially if they're arguing about like patents and things like that, that aren't quite as exciting, like people can walk in and watch. So we had a lot of people who were just like really curious what it was like. On top of that, I did find a number of people who were really in support of us. So a lot of law professors are there, college students, and people who filed what's called amicus briefs or legal briefs in support of our case. We're all kind of seated near us. I didn't know if there were anybody who were like on the other side of things, because I could only talk to so many people from where I was sitting. But it was, you know, for me, I was just almost always entirely focused on what was happening before me, so I didn't really pay attention to the rows of people behind me quite as much.
Okay.
All right, so that wraps our formal program. Could you join me in giving a round of applause?
Thank you.